Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup. In this video, we will talk some of the very basics of the nervous system, some of that terminology you really need to know to get through much of the rest of the year in anatomy, and this will really play a role in terms of some of the clinical concepts as we move throughout the year. So let's start with the most basic of basic, and that is the neuron or nerve cell, which is the main structural and functional units of the nervous system. A lot of the structures we are going to discuss are of a neuron, and neurons are really specialized for rapid communication. There are three major structures of a neuron. There will be the cell body, or soma, which has all the good things a cell should have, like a nucleus, mitochondria, that kind of stuff. Dendrite or dendrites mean little tree or trees, and you can see that these processes kind of resemble tree branches, and there are typically multiple dendrites. Dendrites are going to carry or receive impulses to the cell bodies, okay? So it's kind of to the cell bodies, that's the key. And axons are cellular processes that carry impulses away from the body. And the length of an axon can vary quite significantly. So you can see the dendrites kind of surrounding this region, and you usually have the one axon that can extend a considerable ways. The nervous system is often, for descriptive purposes, split into different systems, and structurally, the nervous system can be split into the central nervous system, or CNS, which consists of the brain and the spinal cord with major functional roles of integration and coordination, and the peripheral nervous system, or PNS, which consists of nerve fibers and cell bodies outside the CNS. These nerve fibers will conduct impulses to or away from the CNS, like we talked about in the last session with afferent and efferent fibers. The PNS will be organized into specific ganglia, which we'll get into in other videos, but also importantly, 12 pairs of cranial nerves and 31 pairs of spinal nerves that will connect the central nervous system with peripheral structures like viscera, muscles, glands, skins, etc. The CNS is going to be organized into gray and white matter, not matter, but matter, based on the gross appearance of these structures. The gray matter is composed primarily of neuronal cell bodies. There are other nervous structures as well, like proximal dendrites, but for our purposes now, let's focus on the cell bodies. And you can see the gray matter is most visible superficially, or on the outer surface of the brain with some deep layers within. The gray matter of the spinal cord forms this butterfly shape that you can see kind of really beautifully here. That's going to be a bit more internal for the spinal cord. We call these wings horns, which are functionally important, and we will get into that in a bit more detail in the next video. White matter is composed of systems of interconnection, primarily aggregations of myelinated, which gives that whitish color, but some unmyelinated axons. So really, axons are kind of key here. White matter in the spinal cord will surround that inner core of gray matter, whereas the white matter in the brain is kind of intermediate in depth. Now let's talk two terms that are specific to the CNS. A nucleus is a collection of cell bodies in the CNS. All right, you will have a very similar description in the peripheral nervous system, but it has another name. These nuclei are often some of these deeper structures of the gray matter, and there are so many nuclei, and they are quite complex, so please don't memorize this image. It's just here to give you an idea of these and where they are located, not to overwhelm you. So just kind of observe where nuclei can be located in the brain. Same thing over here with the tracks. Tracks are nerve axons that often referred to as nerve fiber collections in the central nervous system. These often connect neighboring, but sometimes even distant nuclei of the brain, or can extend up and down the spinal cord, kind of similar to the nerves that we're going to be talking about in the peripheral nervous system. So don't memorize these two images. They're much too complex right now. This is kind of the key stuff I want you to get here. So moving into the peripheral nervous system, let's talk nerves. As mentioned, this is similar to the tracks in the CNS. Nerves consist of nerve fiber bundles, associated connective tissue, this endo and peri and epineurium. And importantly, vasculature is also going to be in a nerve. And we keep bringing up this term, nerve fiber. Sometimes you see nerve fibers described as any neuronal projection. We aren't going with that definition. We're going to be a bit more specific and describe a nerve fiber as an axon plus its neurolemma or plasma membrane and any associated connective tissue. So a nerve is a bunch of those nerve fibers or nerve fiber bundles wrapped up with connective tissue and vasculature. A ganglion is similar to the nucleus of the CNS and is a collection of cell bodies specific to the PNS. So the ganglion is PNS and a nucleus is CNS. And we will see some of these ganglia associated with the sympathetic trunk outside of the spinal cord, but connected. And we'll get into these more when we get into the autonomic nervous system. For spinal nerves and all but the thoracic region, this is thoracic region here. You can see how complex things are when we're looking at the cervical or the brachial region, cervical plexus or brachial plexus. What happens is portions of spinal nerves or specific nerve fibers will not go directly to the structure they innervate, but instead first will form networks of nerves to allow exchange and redistribution from multiple spinal cord levels. So these will often create these multi-segmental peripheral nerves that we often talk about innervating specific muscles, particularly when we're talking about the limbs. So you have a cervical plexus, you'll have a brachial plexus, you'll have a lumbar plexus, you'll have a sacral plexus. You will not have a thoracic plexus. The thoracodorsal nerve, which we discuss in this session, which is innervating latissimus dorsi muscle, will have fibers from C6, C7, and C8 that will kind of get organized within this brachial plexus network. They'll come together in the brachial plexus to form the thoracodorsal nerve, and that will travel to the latissimus dorsi. So it goes through the plexus first before heading to the structure it innervates. All right, excellent. That was a lot of terminology fun, but I know these terms you will be using throughout your career and certainly throughout this year. Please always feel free to reach out with any questions and have a great rest of your day.